Hi, I'm Sarah.
And I'm Sophie.
Join us weekly as we share our insights and personal stories to inspire, motivate, and entertain you from a Gen Z
and a millennial perspective. We'd love it if you could click the button below to like and subscribe and hit that little bell so you never miss us.
If you are listening on Apple Music or Spotify, a 5-star rating would make our day.
So tune in, turn up the volume, and join the conversation.
Making and maintaining friendships and what we value in them.
Mm-hmm. It's such an important conversation to have because so many of us are lonely mm-hmm. and struggle to make friendships. And I think it's something that we realized we really craved during the pandemic when we were forced to be apart and we're really lacking any sort of social interaction.
Yeah, we were isolated. I realized I missed even not so great customer service interactions. Like, you just realize how much you miss people and mm-hmm. how important they are to your lives and your mental well-being.
Absolutely. So at the time of filming this episode, we met a year ago to the week, which is so crazy to think about.
Yeah.
And I'd love to tell the story of how we met because it's an unusual friendship, so.
Definitely. yeah, so for context, we met a year ago at an Italian restaurant that we both worked at. I started a month before Sophie did. They closed about a month ago due to increased rent prices in Vancouver. Love that. So we met working there, and as soon as you started, everyone would mix us up. All of a sudden, I was Sophie and she was Sarah, and vice versa. Like, we were constantly mixed up, and so it became this ongoing joke that we looked like sisters, that we were twins.
Mm-hmm. It was a running joke.
Yeah.
It was pretty funny. But I want to know what your first impression of me was.
So if you see Sophie in real life, she is always dressed to the tens. She always looks so good and so put together. And me being a gen, I like to go out in sweatpants and leggings. I like being comfortable.
Would not be caught dead outside of my house in sweatpants. You could not pay me.
I like being comfy. She likes looking good. The rule she follows is you never know who you're going to meet.
You never know who you're going to run into. And this is controversial opinion. I think it's rude not to look put together because other people have to look at you. So, don't hate me. Don't come for me.
I couldn't care less. I do not care. I like being comfy. I like showing up comfy. That's my motto. So
you do you.
That's where we're like total opposites.
Mm-hmm. In more ways than one.
Yeah.
So
anyway. Yeah, she always looks great and put together. And she would like come into work. Sophie's a very put together person. You come across as very proper. And all of a sudden, me being the total opposite of that, I was like, she's a great coworker, but I don't think we'll ever be friends. Because just judging by first impressions, we were complete opposites.
Mm-hmm.
Complete opposites.
Complete opposites, which was funny because we look so similar, but you could not find two more different people. Well, you could, but we were very different. My first impression of you, I was like, she was constantly on her phone with her long nails, just like clicking and clacking away on her screen.
Yeah, this was on our work computer.
And that too. But you also, you spoke so fast
mm-hmm.
and you shared things about yourself that it took me aback. I was like, okay, I don't know you, but now I know this about you. So
I overshare.
Mm-hmm. But essentially, we really didn't think that we would be where we are today. We couldn't have foreseen it.
Mm-hmm. And then it was like middle of summer at this point. We started going out for drinks after work, just because, you know, after a long shift
mm-hmm.
as a server or a bartender, you you want to go for a drink. You need one. You need one to decompress. And you also want to get to know who you're working with mm-hmm. outside of work. So I was just like, hey, Sophie, you don't want to come for a drink with me?
And I will say I love that about you because you made the first move. You came up to me and you asked me to go for a drink with you. And I was like, sure, why not? And I really appreciate that about you.
Yeah, so we went out, had some drinks, mm-hmm. had some pachos at Bimini's. No, Carlos Surprise. One of the two. yeah, we'd start going out for drinks, just get to chatting, and then we realized we were actually, below the surface, we were really similar. We have like a lot of things in common. Mm-hmm. And then we realized we had this almost like older sister, little sister relationship.
Absolutely.
Because I was kind of going through things that you've already been through.
Mm-hmm. And at the time, we were both actually going through breakups. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's what really bonded us, because it was a really difficult time. And I was able to lean on you for support, and you were able to do the same with me. And why I think our relationship worked so well was what you mentioned before, that you could come to me for advice because of my lived experiences, and what you gave me in return was fun, mm-hmm. a new lease on life. This girl took me clubbing. And I had it like I had not done that in a long time. So it really brought me out of my shell. And I really felt like I had a new lease on life.
Mm-hmm. Which was great. I'm glad I was able to give that to you.
And I'm glad I was able to
give me a big sister.
Yeah.
Isn't that cute?
It's very cute. It's very cute. So I want to know, as a 21-year-old, mm-hmm. how do you go about making friends?
I feel like there's so many different routes to go about that. Mine, because I didn't go to university or college. I dropped out. So I have made actually all my greatest friendships through my working environments. I still have a few friends that stuck from like elementary school. None of them from high school stuck, but all my really important friendships are from either elementary or from workplaces I've been at. So I'm sure other people that are my age have met all their friends through college and more education, mm-hmm. but that wasn't the case for me. I also tend to work in very outgoing environments where I've been able to like make connections with people that are quite similar to me. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know, like that's just where I make them. Or I feel like even online is kind of growing as a way to make friendships. Like most cities have like these girls groups where people be like, come do this with me. Like I'd love to go to yoga, or I have an extra concert ticket. If anyone would like to come along. I think that's a great way to make friendships and meet people. Mm-hmm. I haven't done that personally yet, but yeah, through work, I'd say is the main, mm-hmm. the main contributor to my common denominator in my friendships. Mm-hmm. What about you? As a 32-year-old.
As a 32-year-old, so the older you get, the harder it is to make friends. Mm-hmm. And I read a study that said that after 25 years old, the amount of friends you have, your social circle decreases in number significantly. And that's for a ton of different reasons. Around that age, a lot of people tend to get into longer term relationships. They will start families. They will get into more serious stages of their careers. And so your attention is on these other parts of your life, and a lot of your friendships fall by the wayside. And I was certainly guilty of this. I was in a long-term relationship, and I really lost a lot of friends because I didn't make an effort. Mm-hmm. I didn't reach out to my friends consistently. I wasn't prioritizing making plans with my girlfriends. and those relationships suffered. And as a result, when my relationship ended, I really felt very, very alone. And it was one of those moments in my life when I realized, wow, I need to make this a priority in my life. It is so important to have a person or a group of people that you can consistently rely on. The benefits of having friends, I cannot sing it from the rooftops loud enough. Mm-hmm. It's such an important part of your life that a lot of us really neglect.
Because, yeah, we also related because we both felt that we isolated ourselves mm-hmm. in our relationships. And that's something that we're trying to change for ourselves mm-hmm. and realize that our girlfriends need more attention, need more prioritization mm-hmm. in our lives. Because, you know, when things eventually maybe come to an end, who do you rely on? Mm-hmm. Also having, you know, when you do get into a partnership, having friends outside of that or a life outside of that is also so healthy and so beneficial for your relationship. Like, there couldn't be any more pros to having friends in your life.
Absolutely. Girl talk, or this sort of, I like to call it a sacred practice, women speaking with each other. Mm-hmm. It is a cathartic experience for us. It's where we get to express all of our thoughts and emotions, and where our friends get to give us their input and their insight, and it makes you feel lighter mm-hmm. and it makes you feel loved, and it's like a almost ritualistic, right? It's such an important part of who we are as women. Mm-hmm.
And this dates back as well.
Yeah, it sure does. It absolutely does. Yeah, it's a forever thing. Forever. It's happened for millennia. Mm-hmm.
Mm. I love the way that you, how you put that. Like, it's a sacred practice. It's a ritual.
It really is. Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah. In terms of how to make friends in your 30s, that's a tough one. You're short on time. Mm-hmm. You have a busy life. It's about mindset. You need to change your mindset and prioritize spending time making friends. Here's a cool fact. It takes 50 hours of spending time with someone in order for them to become a casual friend. It takes 200 hours of spending time with a person in order for them to become a close friend. That's a lot of hours. That's a lot of
time. Nobody has that kind of time these days.
Well, but that's the thing. You have to make time. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's about prioritizing making that time weekly to invest in building friendships. Mm-hmm. The way to make friends, one really helpful tip I've always done this is proximity is your friend. Quite literally, find people who live in your neighborhood, better still, who live in your building.
If you live in an apartment.
If you live in an apartment building, find someone who lives in your building so you can start like a friend style situation. It's like on a lonely weeknight or on a weekend day, if they have a dog, go walk the dog together. You know, if you've got nothing to do on a Thursday night, just text them and be like, hey, I've got a bottle of wine. Do you want to come over? Whatever it is. But make allowances that fit within your lifestyle. If you really like certain activities, if you really like playing tennis, playing volleyball, join a community. Pick up a new hobby on the way, and then you will meet like-minded people as well. Mm-hmm. So to me, that it's mindset, proximity and making the time, fitting that into your weekly routine.
Well, proximity also goes hand in hand with like me having made most of my friends at work. Totally. It's just, it's where they are in comparison to you. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
And hobbies is a big one. I feel like in this day and age of social media, hobbies can really be neglected.
Mm-hmm.
I saw this TikTok talking about how women do have hobbies. It's like little things like cooking that we overlook as being hobbies.
Ooh,
like
I love baking. That.
And so I realized I actually have more hobbies than I thought I did. But another thing I like to say is like social media is my hobby at this point. With like TikTok being huge and, you know, a lot of us spend hours day in like scrolling through our social media apps, I consider social media to be a hobby.
That's actually such a good point to reframe it in your mind as mm-hmm. not being a bad habit, but being a hobby. If you enjoy something, it's allowed to be a hobby for sure.
But also what I think now because of social media is we neglect doing hobbies outside of our phones.
Well, I mean, you send me a lot of TikToks that you like. So, I mean, we are sharing those moments together, even though we're apart. Mm-hmm. And that leads into the next point is how do you maintain friendships?
Well, quickly going back there, though, because I feel like if you do pick up hobbies like pottery or whatnot that are outside of, you know, your little safe bubble, is a great way to also meet people mm-hmm. in your like-minded minds.
Absolutely.
That are like-minded to you. So reframing your mindset on social media being, necessarily a bad thing, but it's something you should have to, limit your time on so you have a healthy relationship with it. But also, getting outside of, your little comfort bubble and doing things outdoors, whether that's joining, hiking groups or whatever, doing something out there in an environment with other people as a way to make friends.
I will say on that, too, I know we are both extroverts,
mm-hmm.
and there are people who are introverted,
mm-hmm.
and it might be even more difficult for them to make friends in social settings. But I think you could join groups where you might find other people who have similar personalities to you, like book clubs.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great thing. I know one of our local libraries, they hold seminars there where you discuss things that you've read and you have authors who come and share what they've written.
That's so cool.
Yeah, but even a yoga class could be a really special thing to do because it is a personal practice,
mm-hmm.
but with other people around, and you're not forced to interact, but
That
option is available where you're not forced to interact with somebody, but you can if you want to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There's so many, whether that be dance class or just mm-hmm. fitness class in general, there's so many options available for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So
maintaining friendships,
how would you go about that?
It would kind of depend on which friends. My closest friends I try and see as much as possible, whether a text message hey, what are you doing this week, what are you doing this weekend, let's hang out, let's go for a drink, let's go do this event that I see is happening. My friends that date back to elementary school that I'm still close with, we are all very different people. You know, one thing I remember you saying is, if you were to meet your childhood friend today, would you still be friends with them?
That's such a good question.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'd be friends with my elementary school friends if I met them today. But it's not to say that's a bad thing or that I dislike my friendship with them. I think childhood friends are great for your inner child.
Ooh.
I feel like it's a great way to just stay connected to that innocence, that sweet innocence part, sweet innocent part of you that'll always still be there. And it's such a comfort friendship to me.
That's such a beautiful thought.
And
I love that.
So because we're all such different people with different schedules, I don't see them as much, but me and my friend Angela, our birthdays are, her birthday's Christmas Eve. Mine is a week after Christmas. And so we always hang out around that time period to celebrate our birthdays and Christmas together. And then my friend Kayla's birthday is in the fall, and my friend Daniel's birthday is in the spring. So we hang out at least once around those two times as well. And then we usually find like some cool like group activities to like do during the year, whether that's certain like events, like an art exhibit or whatever. And we just were like, hey, are you guys interested? Let's buy tickets, let's do this. So I don't see them as often, but they are friendships that I appreciate and I love so much. And like we all come together, like it's hard to get a group of like four people together. Like we're living all very different lives, but we make that time at least a couple times a year. And we just kind of like pick back up where we left off. My other friendships that I've, you know, met through work or wherever, I mean, we essentially communicate daily, like through social media, whether that be like we send a picture to each other on Snapchat or we're sending like TikToks or memes to each other. But I make sure to like hang out with them at least like bi-weekly. I know sometimes like that can be a bit of a stretch, but like we have that daily communication through at least some means, which keeps us really close. Or I'll even send like videos on Snapchat of like me giving like a little rundown of what my life is looking like right now, and that's a matter of like staying in touch. But yeah, so we have like some sort of daily communication. Yeah. And then we also do make time to like see each other when we can in real life, face to face.
The Snapchat thing is still so weird to me. Like I'll receive them and it's just Sarah talking on her bed, talking about what she's done that day, but like she just sends it to like a ton of people and
not all the time.
Well,
I select a few friends.
A fair few. But it's like a pre-shift at work, like a meeting. Like this is what I did today. Point, 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 point. Okay, bye. Cool, good to know. Thanks for sharing. That's like, as a millennial, it's such a weird concept to wrap my head around. But I love it. I think it's cool. It's like a little memo.
Yeah. So how do you maintain friendships? Being 11 years older than me.
I do have to point out that I had an unusual upbringing. And so maintaining friendships is something I've struggled with. Making friends has never been an issue for me because from the time I was born, essentially, I moved from country to country. Every few years, I was consistently the new kid at school. And therefore, I'm very good at getting integrated into a new group and building friendships. But where it falls apart is because I moved, those friendships would fall by the wayside. And it continued into my early 20s as well, because after I left school, I traveled for a number of years. And that realization that I had during the pandemic, where I sat there and thought about, you know, how I missed people. And I realized I hadn't been placing as much value on my friendships as I should have been. And I was letting others take the lead in the maintenance department of friendships. I was looking through messages and I realized, wow, I don't initiate the conversations. You know, I just respond. And it was a very selfish mindset that I was in. And so my challenge that I set for myself was to be a better friend. And so now the way I maintain friendships is I like to text my friends fairly often. We all have tiers of friendships, right? Mm-hmm. Like close friends, good friends, acquaintances, strangers.
Yeah.
My close friends, I would count maybe six people, not including family. And maintaining those friendships to me looks like sending a text frequently, multiple times a week, asking, how are you doing? if they shared some information with me about, hey, I'm getting a haircut this week, I'm gonna put that in my calendar to remind me, and then ask them, hey, how was your haircut? Are you happy with it? You know? Or they have a job interview. That's a big one. Or, you know, oh, my cat was unwell. And I will literally calendarize those important things that they share to me that I know to be important to them in order to be able to reach out and have a meaningful conversation, and so that they know that I genuinely care about them. That's the way I maintain that.
I never thought of doing that, like putting things like a calendar to make sure you remember and can be like reminded about asking so on and so forth about whatever event. Mm-hmm. I like that.
Thank you.
That's some good advice. I'm learning some stuff.
With friends that I maybe see not so often, I'll reach out every couple of months and we'll organize drinks or a dinner, and it's enough to maintain that level of relationship, mm-hmm. right? And that's okay. For me...
Because you also have friends that are spread out throughout the world.
Oh, man.
So how do you...
It is awesome to have friends all over the world. It's also really hard. It's really hard.
Because, like, maintaining those friendships, the most you can really do is, like, a FaceTime call.
Yeah.
And, like, still that can be a bit much. Like, it's hard for people to, like, organize that time, especially if it's, like, different time zones. Like, so a lot of the time... you could only really like text or like respond to like their most recent social media post, be like, just saw that, like you got a new dog or whatever, adorable. Mm-hmm. But then I think it's also like kind of a mutual thing where you understand that there's like a world between you two. And so.
Not only that, but I have this, the way I think about friendships that you've made while you were traveling, for example, is that it feels like an alternate reality. Mm-hmm. You were both living in almost like a fantasy life where you could be whoever you wanted to be when you met that person. You were experiencing a new culture, having a ton of new experiences in a short amount of time.
Yeah.
And when you make friends in that sort of environment, it's not a gradual thing. It's a 0 to 100 thing. If you've traveled and you've made friends while traveling, you know what I mean. Like, you become attached at the hip with complete strangers within a day or two.
Because essentially you're doing everything with them.
Everything, yeah. And so just as intense as that friendship grew, you are then apart when you go home. But the next time you meet up, it's like zero time has passed and you're transported back to that feeling that you had when you were experiencing so many new things together. That's what's so special about those friendships. So you can go years without talking and all of a sudden you'll post on your Instagram story, hey, I'll be in Paris next week. And someone will reach out that you met a decade ago and be like, no way, I'll be there at the same time. And then you meet up, even if it's for a 45-minute coffee, but it's like instantly you're
like no time has passed.
Nothing, yeah. It's unreal. I don't know if it's because the friendship is not based on circumstance. It's based on like who memories. You are in memories, but who you are in your heart. Mm. It's like a heart friendship.
That's cute.
Thank you.
So how do you maintain those friendships? I guess because if you can go years without talking, it's just...
It's like you said...
You don't really talk or you just...
You don't really talk. Like you said, you might comment on a picture every now and then. They might respond to your story and you have a quick little convo like, what are you up to, you know? And it just exists like that. And that's okay. That's really okay.
What's that?
Yeah. Yeah.
What about your childhood friends?
If I would still be friends with them today?
Mm-hmm.
I really like what you said about those friendships. Those friendships being like where you relive your innocence.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of whether we'd be friends today, I think yes, but I think if we met, we probably wouldn't meet today. That's the distinction, because we're so different.
Mm.
My very, very best friend, Samui, who we met when we were 9 months old at a daycare in Malaysia, where we both lived at the time with our families. We went through our entire lives essentially together. And she is now married with a child. And I just think about if we were like, if we'd never met before, how would we meet?
Yeah.
Because she's a wife and a mother, and I'm a single gal.
Childless.
Where would we meet? You know?
But that's she's an interesting perspective.
Yeah. But she is the best human I know, and I love her very much. And forever grateful to have a friendship like that in my life that spans essentially almost our entire lifetime.
3 decades.
Jesus. Wow.
I'm it's really crazy aging to think you about. On this podcast.
You are. Thank you for pointing that out repeatedly.
You look great and the amount of wisdom you carry.
Thank you.
It's also beautiful.
That's very nice.
It's as beautiful as you.
Oh, I appreciate it.
Crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. It is crazy to think about.
I love that tip though about putting things in like calendars, like remember, like jotting it down as like a little note, because I was just trying to go off my memory.
It's really important to, I know you care about your friends.
Mm-hmm.
Your friends know you care about them, but just like when you're in a relationship and you want your partner to do special things for you, to surprise you with flowers or breakfast in bed or whatever it is, why are you not doing that for your friends, is my mm-hmm. question. You know, if you know your friend loves London Fog flavored things, you bring them London Fog donuts every once in a while.
If you know your friend loves, you know, matcha, you bring her matcha treats when you come across them.
There you go.
Speaking of which, I have some...
What did you bring?
I think it's birthday cake matcha or something like that. I have some matcha tea for you in my bag.
Did you really? That's so nice. I'm so excited.
I also forgot. We're like, oh, we have things. We're like, I have something in my bag. I literally brought for you today.
Thank you. I'm so excited.
I know. I was like, oh, it's ice cream matcha. It's ice cream matcha tea.
If you have never tried matcha ice cream, get one.
I actually don't know if I have.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my God. Okay, we're next time we hang out, we're going for matcha ice cream.
Okay. I'm on board with that. I'm ice cream gal.
Anyway.
But so, kind of going back to like what you do and don't do in what you do in relationships, you should also do in your friendships. What we kind of realized mutually with a friend we were kind of making is relationship red flags and green flags can be used for both platonic and romantic relationships,
mm-hmm.
which I feel people overlook. Hmm. I know I did. I didn't even think about that until like a couple months ago. And we're like, this person is checking off so many red flags that I would look for in a relationship. Why am I not considering that for this platonic friendship too, as reasons to not be friends with them?
That's a loaded one,
mm-hmm.
but it is incredibly true.
Mm-hmm.
People can behave in narcissistic ways and take advantage of people in friendships as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really important to protect yourself. from things like that.
And we can definitely do like a deep dive another day about like, you know, kind of like the red flags in friendships and like what to avoid. But looking at the green flags, like what do you value in friendships and what are things you would want in a relationship, a romantic relationship, that you would also want in a platonic relationship?
I think for me, what I love most and what I look for in my friendships, and now that I'm older, I have less time, and I'm almost like I have a higher expectation of my friendships. I love people who inspire me, mm-hmm. people who are creatively driven. Though being around people who lift you up energetically, vibrationally, put you in a good mood, who inspire you to be a better human. Mm-hmm. So those are the qualities that I look for.
It's so riveting. Wrong use of the word.
No, it's
I'm
not.
I'm so illiterate.
You're riveted. That's fair. That's a huge compliment. Thank you.
But I mean, like, yeah, those relationships are just feel very riveting.
Mm-hmm.
I love that. And we're meeting a lot of creative people right now.
Yeah, we really are.
Upon wanting to start this project, the amount of people that have just been flowing into our lives that just align with us and our passions and our interest is crazy.
And the point about that is that we had to become the creatively minded, motivated people in order to attract those people into our lives.
And I know not everyone believes in like energy, vibrations, the universe, but we do. And it's been crazy. It's yeah. been powerful upon embarking on this journey.
Mm-hmm.
The amount of things that are just aligned in our worlds.
Mm-hmm. But I think that's a really good a good point, is that in order for you to attract the friendships that you want in your life, you need to also be able to reciprocate
mm-hmm.
and provide that to others, whatever it is that you're looking for.
Yeah, be that for yourselves. I mean, like, once again, we always see, you know, you have to love yourself before you can, like, love a partner in a relationship. Like, it's the same thing with a friendship.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's, yeah, the things you would look for romantically, you also need to put, like, into perspective of how you would look for that platonically.
Do you think you're a good friend?
I would hope so. I mean, I'm big on quality time for friendships, and I always make it very clear to the people in my life, my love language is gift giving. So if I start randomly surprising you with things that, you know, remind me of you, like, that is me showing my love and appreciation for someone. I can be really bad at texting. Whoopsies. I'm really bad at getting back online. But if I make plans with you, I stick to them. Like, if I make time for you, I'm sticking to that. I'm devoting that time to you. My love language is gift giving, both platonically and romantically. I will, like, buy, like, little things. I will treat you when I can. Like,
mm-hmm.
I'm broke right now. But when I have the money, like, I love to, like, treat people to, like, coffees or, like, lunch or, like,
yeah.
I'll cover, like, the first round of drinks, like, whatever that is.
Those are two qualities in you that I love, is that you're extremely thoughtful and you don't cancel.
I can be late.
You can be late, but you will not cancel, and that's huge. You are true to your word,
mm-hmm.
and you are very, very thoughtful.
You're very thoughtful.
Am I?
Yeah.
Thank you.
You always remember the little things, and I remember it was like...
Well, now you know my secret.
But yeah, like, you're so thoughtful. It was like a month to my birthday. I was like, what am I going to do for my birthday? It's like a week, like 2 days after New Year's. It's hard to coordinate things at that time of year. It's like, what am I going to do? Like, I have to think in advance. I want to book a hotel. That's going to be booked up. Like, I was born in a tricky time of year. It's hard to coordinate plans. It's a tricky time. And I was like, oh, like my birthday's in a month. Like, I need to start thinking of, like, what to do. And you kind of just briefly overheard. You're like, oh, what are we doing for your birthday? I was like, oh, and then you show up on my birthday and you have, like, something we talk about and, like, a DM, like, a few weeks before. Like, you're just, always remember the little things. And you're also so wise. You always, like, offer advice when people are in need of it. And you have such great energy and you're such a bright, vibrant person. Like, someone dropped literally an hour ago. We were walking behind someone on the street. They dropped a receipt. I'm like, who needs a receipt? She drops it up. We follow him a block until the next place he went in to be like, sorry, sir. Like, I don't know if you need this, but you dropped your receipt. Like, but it's so cute. Like, you're so caring. Your energy in doing that, it's always so positive. You can just tell that you're such a kind and genuine human being. And just like in the little things you do.
Don't make me cry. Don't do that. Don't make me cry.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're a beautiful person inside and out.
Thank you. I love you.
Do not cry.
Don't.
We're fanning her tears. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think on that note. On that note. Yeah. Thank you for joining us today.
Yeah. Well, on that note, there's an outro next. Listen to that. Whatever it is.
Listen to whatever's happening after this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks for watching. As always, we really appreciate your input, so feel free to reach out to us with any feedback, comments, or suggestions for future episodes.
If you'd like to support us, please subscribe and leave a rating and review on your favorite platform so you stay connected and up to date.
See you next week.